Hallelujah. Luke chapter 2, verse number 1. Bible reads like this: "And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor over Syria, and all went to be taxed, every one into his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth into Judea, out of the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn." Oh man, most powerful story. We've heard it so many times. Sometimes it just becomes, we'll let it become old hat. But here is an ordering of events, and a chronicle of glory that was humbled into humanity. And so here they are. She brought forth her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. The Savior of the world is born, and there's no room. Jesus passed through those parts 2,000 years ago, and the world has never been the same since then. And I think we'd all have to admit that Christmas, to one degree or another, has been ruined and perverted by an unbelieving world. If that's really what Christmas is, then it's been ruined and perverted. It seems that the praise has given way to the party. You know what I'm saying? And the Savior has given way to Santa. And glory has been exchanged for gift. And that bows have been replaced with bows. Amen. In this world that we live in, I want to remind us today, though, that Christmas, this Christmas season, is a whole lot more than that. Amen. I want to put it this way. It's a lot more than boxes, bows, and ribbons. It's more than trees, tinsel, and lights. It's certainly more than reindeers, rooftops, and ho-ho-hos. It wasn't Santa Claus that came to earth that first Christmas, but it was heaven itself that came down to earth when heaven visits earth. Amen? And so we started verses 1 and verses 1 through 5. We see God's providence in this. First of all, Caesar Augustus issues his decree for the taxing. It wasn't a lucky coincidence that resulted in Jesus being born in Bethlehem. Neither was it. It wasn't mere inconvenience for the people of Israel, but it was God's divine providence and ordering of events that caused this imperial decree by Caesar Augustus. Amen. You see, for those who don't know, amen, there was a promise given in Micah chapter number 5 and verse 2. Said, "But thou, Bethlehem Ephratah, though thou be a little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of thee shall he come forth unto me, that is to be ruler in Israel, whose goings forth have been from of old, from everlasting." And so there the prophet Micah, he declared that the Messiah would be born in that little town called Bethlehem. That was literally in that time and in that age. And you have to realize that the city of the town of Bethlehem, with its character, with the people that had come out of it, it had been referred to, if we could put it in our English language, as the armpit of the civilized world. It was a town of shepherds, you know. It wasn't It wasn't the Taj Mahal is what we're trying to say. Amen. But you also have to think about this. This Micah wasn't just a few years before Christ was born, but the prophet Micah lived 700 years before the birth of Christ. And he prophesied, amen, that it would be in Bethlehem that this baby would be born, and he foretold his birthplace. Amen. But there was a problem with it. The prophet said that the Messiah would come from Bethlehem, but Joseph and Mary lived in Nazareth, over 80 miles away. Now, 80 miles, you know, doesn't seem all that far today. You and I can drive that in an hour and 20 minutes. Or less or more, depending upon stoplight speed limits and everything else. But it's really not that far. We jump in our comfortable car and we can go. Amen. But it probably never entered Joseph and Mary's mind while they were in Nazareth to go to Bethlehem. But here come the decree from Caesar Augustus. And they made that journey and traveled. We all know it was hard and it was treacherous. You know, the cops weren't just minutes away. There weren't police officers patrolling the roads, just right down the way like it was for us. But there were robbers. There were no McDonald's. There were no gas stations or rest stops. Amen. You walked. If you had to use the little boys or little girls' room, there wasn't one. And you had to find somewhere to do it. If you wanted safety, you had to find a group of people to travel with. Amen. But an 80-mile trip would have been terribly hard, on an expectant mother. Amen. But Joseph was of the house of David. Luke 1:27. Bethlehem was called the city of David, and God arranged all these things to ensure that his son would be born in the right place at the right time. And he even used a pagan emperor to do it. Amen. You say, well, what does all this matter? It's neat. Yes. Well, let me get to it. Amen. Tonight on this. But that's just a small picture. There's thousands of messianic prophecies that came true in Christ. But if we read on in verses 6 and 7 of our text, amen, we find the place of his birth was in the manger. Amen, that manger, literally a feeding trough. The King of all kings and the Lord of all lords, the one who come to save, who the Galatians, amen, and Revelation declare that one of these days every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that he is Lord. Amen. He was born in that little old manger. Amen. Why was that? Well, for two reasons. First, the immediate reason was is that some old shepherds would be able to find him. Just any old anybody. Amen. But the eternal reason, amen, that he was born in a manger is that some old sinner might be able to identify with him and approach him for salvation. Amen. He was born like a man. In fact, he was born as a lowly, poor, amen, home, poor man. Amen. So that nobody could look at it and say, look at that king. I can never be like him. No, he was born in a lowly manger. Amen. So that he could be like the lowest of the low. Amen. The humbled of the humbled. The most humble of all those with humility. Amen. So that all could know that they could come to him for salvation tonight. Amen. There we also see the picture, amen, that God gives us in his birth. He was wrapped in swaddling clothes. Amen. And we know that those swaddling clothes were literally rendered bandages. Amen. Others would render them menstrual cloths. Amen. They weren't nice things, but this more like a bandage. Amen. These baby wraps prefigure. Amen. Even at his own birth, he was wrapped in bandage cloths. That's what they had. And you know, when he died on that cross, they wrapped him up. Amen. And with those burial cloths, and even in his
birth. Amen. He was telling us what he was going to do. Amen. At his death. Why did Jesus come? Well, he came to die for you and me. He came to die for the lowliest of sinners. Amen. He came to give his life so that I could live. Amen. So you see, the purpose in the birth of Christ was the salvation of the soul of man. Jesus was a baby born with the purpose of dying. You and I are always looking for a purpose. We talked about, our purpose in Christ is to obey even under the death of Christ. Amen. We've been preaching about the flesh in days gone by. You know how that old flesh needs to die that we might live under Christ. Amen. But Jesus, from the very beginning, was destined to die on that cross. Amen. He had been expected for thousands of years. And we know that. We see, amen, from the very from the fall in the Garden of Eden in Genesis chapter 3 all the way through every lamb, every ram, every goat, every bird that had been sacrificed through the ages pointed to this one man's special birth. Amen. To this one special moment. Amen. That was to take place. Amen. Every single lamb died. Amen. As a picture. Amen. He is why no built an ark to the saving of his people. Amen. Why? Amen. It was built with such precision. Amen. As a saving place. It's why. He is why Abraham built that altar unto God and went to sacrifice his own son when the ram came out of the thicket. Amen. Jesus is why Moses built the tabernacle in the wilderness. Amen. Jesus is why Solomon built a temple. Amen. With such beauty for the God to reside in. Amen. Hallelujah. And Jesus is why. Amen. God in his foreknowledge built a hill called Golgotha or Calvary. Amen. He came to be our Savior. And his great purpose in all of that is you tonight. Amen. You, hallelujah. We see God put on a powerful display for us in the birth of Jesus. The power of God was on parade before the eyes of men. If we read on in verse 8 of Luke 2, we see the power of God's grace. And there was in the same country shepherds abiding over their flocks by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. Amen. Shepherds were outcast by society as vile and filthy, outcast by religion as unfit to worship. However, they were chosen by Almighty God to hear the very first birth announcement. Amen. How appropriate that the very men who raised the lambs that were to be sacrificed at the temple were the very first ones, amen, to hear and to meet the very Lamb of God who was to take away their sins forever. Amen. They raised them little lambs. They sold them to folks that were going to take them to their yearly sacrifice. Amen. Oh, glory to God. But now the Lamb of God himself, amen, he's shown to just who he is. Amen. What grace that God has. Amen. Glory to God. We see God's glory. Verse 13, and suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill towards men. And we hear the praise of the angel. Amen.